everyone, Jason with Hermetheus Coffee here, wanting to do a review of something that I decided to take a little bit of a gamble on. I need a sample roaster that is more consistent than using my current Artisan 6 as a sample roaster. The Coffee Crafters Artisan 6 is what I use just as a small commercial roaster. Fantastic roaster, it makes exceptional coffee, and if you follow my other videos, you know that I've completely converted it to some robotic PID controls so that I use Artisan software to completely automate the roast profile of my coffee. Here's the challenge that that presents. When I go to sample brand new coffees, I can't match a profile that I use in my commercial coffees. Because if I use the Artisan, my Artisan 6, then my temperature probes aren't placed to where they can measure the temperature of the small amount of coffee beans that are in there, 200 grams or so. If I use something like a Bemore, a little drum roaster, something that can adequately handle 200 grams of coffee, it just bakes it. It's not great coffee. It's terrible. So the easy answer here is to go with the iKawa Pro, the Pro 50, the Pro 100. These are automated sample roasters that use air. They're a fluid bed roasting process like my Coffee Crafters Artisan, so the flavor profiles would be similar, and you can import different profiles. I mean, on paper, everything about the iKawa Pro 50 or Pro 100 looks great, except for one thing, and that is the price. Those things are, to get them here in the United States, $4,000 for the 50 gram unit, $5,000 for the 100 gram unit. That's too much cheddar for someone like me. So here's what I'm gonna find out. Will this little roaster that we can find on AliExpress work as a replacement for an iKawa? I wanna get into the guts of this thing and then ultimately convert this thing over to PID control as well. But let's just take a look at the overview of this and kind of the overall build quality. It goes under a few different names, but it's often called Smola, S-M-O-L-A. ZC Roasters calls it the BC-150 and the BC-300. The difference between those two, they make a 150 gram version of this and a 300 gram version. I bought the 300 gram version. I'm still not convinced I made the right choice on that. My logic was, I want to be able to roast a 200 gram sample, which is your standard sample size from coffee roasters. And they claim that this has a minimum sample size of 150 grams. Well, here's why I'm rethinking getting the 300 gram. And I haven't landed on this yet, but what if I want to take a 200 gram sample and roast two different profiles out of it? I might want to roast 100 grams using one profile and then 100 more grams using a different profile. And according to the manufacturer, this won't work well on 100 gram batch size. So that will yet to be determined on that, but we're going to take a look at this. This is the manual version where you manually control your loft, you manually control your heat. They have another version of this that has a touchscreen with PID control, and that was tempting, but here's why I didn't go with it. Because if you've watched my other videos and you've seen me dial in PID, PID tuning is very critical. And it's gonna vary by probe placement, probe type, bean type. You need really granular control over PID parameters to really dial this thing in. And if you get the touchscreen version that has those PID controls, it's not configurable. Those PID values are not configurable. So it's really, you're really putting a lot of faith in the Chinese company that made this to find a single set of PID parameters that work for everything. And I just know that that's not gonna be the case. So I wanted full control over this thing. This fully baked was $576. That includes getting it shipped to my doorstep. It took just under 2 weeks from the time I placed the order on AliExpress to the time it showed up at my door. So I'm really happy with both the price of this and the speed that they got it to me. It was very well packed. Nothing was broken. The instruction manual is complete garbage, so throw that thing away. You won't really figure anything out. And in fact, this little diverter right here, I don't know what, it's gonna help add some turbulence into the bean mass. It doesn't even show what you do with that. I had to look at some of the pictures from their website to figure out what to even do with that thing. So initial thoughts on the build quality of this. I know it's cheap, Chinese manufacturing, so I had to temper my expectations. And so I knew, for instance, that these little temperature gauges or power meters are just little cheap. You know, they're just a few bucks a piece on Amazon. I'm sure the potentiometers aren't great. But the case itself, I'm actually impressed with. It's thicker than I thought it would be. I have other Chinese equipment. I do have one of those vibratory wave fill machines that I sometimes use to bag coffee. And the gauge of metal is super thin, and they're death traps. They're like razor sharp on some of the edges. So what I'm already impressed with here are some of the rounded corners that we have on the metal. Even some of the louvered vents. These are all very, very chamfered, or maybe they just use a thick enough paint or powder coat to really soften this, but there are no sharp edges on this. And it's, while I wouldn't call it super heavy gauge, it's not as thin as I feared that it would be. It has on the end here an air intake air filter that's on here. So the build quality just at first glance was perhaps on par, maybe slightly better than I was expecting. Here's the one gem. This is the one thing that absolutely blew me away in a positive, positive way. It's the roast chamber itself. Guys, this thing is solid. The top here, it's billet aluminum anodized, and it is heavy. It is not thin at all, and it's very well done. The roast chamber itself, man, when you see the pictures of it, you wonder how thin it is. And I really thought it would be as thin as a vase or something. This is almost half a centimeter thick borosilicate glass. So I put some calipers on it. It's 4.5 millimeters thick. This is a beefy, beefy roast chamber. And the bottom here, it is just thick. I mean, this thing weighs a lot. It feels really, really solid. You're not just gonna bump into this with something and accidentally shatter. You're gonna have to actually drop this to the ground to get it. So super impressed with the quality, thickness, and sturdiness of the actual roast chamber. So will those translate to what we have on the inside of this roaster? Well, I am gonna do a complete teardown and take a look, but I've already pulled the back of this unit off. Because the very first thing we've got to do, they don't offer a US voltage version of this. So it comes with a plug that is not made for United States voltage. So this runs on 220 because they claim it's a 3000 watt roaster. We're going to test that to see if that's the case. It's probably not. But before I can even power it on, I've got to swap out this power cord. And so I need to get to the inside of it. And I've already taken it apart, and I've already taken off the power controller. I'll get to this thing in just a second here. But I want to give the very first big red flag that came up on this thing. And that has to do with the air filter. So I've already showed that we have this intake air filter, but let's take a look at the motor that's inside. So this is your blower motor that goes inside. When you fully seat this air filter, look at the gap that exists right in there. It's a good, I don't know, quarter inch gap that exists between the air filter and the air intake of the motor itself. Guys, it's completely pointless. If they didn't design the gap to like mate up and seal, why did they even bother with the expense and the materials to add an air filter to this thing? And the only answer that I can come up with is it looks good in the pictures. And heck, I fell for it. I said, oh yeah, air filter, that's nice. But yeah, complete junk. I guess you don't even really need this thing on here. The next thing we go to, they advertise. So this is the power regulator. And so one of your potentiometers plugs into this. I've already unplugged it, but it'll plug into this board right here. It's like a 500K variable resistance potentiometer that controls the output of this. And so this board you can also buy on AliExpress. And they're going to claim that it's an SCR or an LED dimmer. It is not. We can definitively see that this is a simple triac. And it might work for this application, but man, you wouldn't want to use it on a motor. You wouldn't want to use it on LEDs because triacs, unlike an SCR, they chop up the sine wave from here to the upside down. So it's nothing that I'd want to use on a motor. These things are notorious for burning up like shaded pole motors and LED light circuits. Perhaps the one thing that they're adequate for is controlling a purely resistive load like an incandescent light bulb, or, in the case of a fluid bed coffee roaster, our heating element is a purely resistive load. So as noisy, these things give off tons of EMI, so as noisy and choppy as the sine wave is, perhaps this is one of the very few applications where it is an adequate device to use for this. We're gonna find out, and we'll see how many watts this thing actually draws, but they do, to their credit, they do use a thermal paste to mount the triac to this, to the aluminum. It mounts up high. It mounts in these two holes right up here, so it sits right underneath the top. I find that to be an odd placement for something that needs to stay cool, because as heat rises within this, and it sits right above the resistive heater, I find it odd that they wouldn't mount this underneath everything, whereas it's drawing in cool air underneath, that cool air would then hit this and then go up and out. It just seems like an odd placement for that, but we're gonna dig into that. So the very first thing I'm gonna do is replace this power cord, and then in the process of that, we'll take a closer look at the heating element itself. Oh, the motor, the intake motor is just an L22 vacuum motor. So this thing you can buy on AliExpress for under 10 bucks. They market it as a handheld vacuum motor. So because it's under 10 bucks, yes, it is a cheap motor, but it is metal, it is ball bearing, and I think it's around 30,000 RPM. It has a full spec sheet available. You can see what the lift and airflow values are, and in fact, even the current loads, it says that at peak draw, it's gonna be around 350 watts. So, I mean, there are other cheap Chinese coffee roasters that use like a literal plastic squirrel cage motors. This is at least a step up from that. Should be an adequate motor. We're gonna find out. But let me get this thing taken apart and we'll continue. I have removed the stock electrical cord that came with it, and I didn't like how this was routed. So this is the bottom of the machine right here, and the stock cord came through the bottom here, and then as soon as it came out, it had this tight 90 degree bend, because these feet are only about an inch tall, and I don't like that 90 degree bend that was on there. So the very first thing I did was to just use a stepper drill bit and put a heavier cord directly through the back of this thing. And on my ground wire, I've got a little barrel connector crimped on there so that I can properly chassis ground this thing. But I can now see inside the unit, and we can get a better idea of the few pieces that we couldn't see before. So let's see here. This little board right here connects directly to this knob right here. So this is your loft motor controller. And once again, this is just a simple little triac, and it's all just on one board, including the potentiometer. So that potentiometer just goes directly onto this board. That's a little heat sink. I know it's a little bit hard to see, but basically, guys, another cheap little triac here, and it is controlling our loft motor. I don't love that our motor is being driven by such a choppy sine wave signal. At least it's not a shaded pole motor, so maybe it'll last a little bit longer. But man, again, this whole thing is under $600. So even if I had to, well, first of all, I think there are only about $100 worth of parts in here, because the heater unit, this heater unit right here is, it's just a Raina, R-A-Y-N-A. It's claimed a 3000 watt heating unit for air. And this is what does your heating right here. These two things are just, they're K-type thermocouples that go in, I'm having a hard time adjusting things. They sit right in the throat of this. So they both measure your air temperature. So they are both ET probes. One of them connects to a digital display on the front. The other is, it's just wired up and hooks to nothing on the inside. And the intention is that you could hook this up to Artisan Roaster Scope software. They sell another add-on USB converter that will allow you to plug this into Artisan. I'm not going to use that. I may or may not use this ET probe. In my experience, they're not very good. They're very noisy and not very good to begin with. But for PID control, your environment temperature, your ET, doesn't do anything. You don't even need to know it. It is what it needs to be to get your beans to the right temperature. What really matters is our bean temperature probe, which will mount right here. They offer a threaded connector for your bean temperature mount. And I've got a few different options, including an RTD. RTDs are much better. They're platinum. They have much. They have a much lower noise floor. I've got another video on that. But I don't think that my RTD probe is going to work for this. It's way too long. It's about 6 inches long, which is just going to be way oversized for this. So I might have to go with a K-type thermocouple. But this heater unit here is under $50. I've already shown that our motor is under $10. These Triac-based motor controllers are $10-$20 a piece. All said, there's probably under $100 worth of total materials on the inside of this. My hunch is this is probably $100+ in actual parts costs. And then of course you've got your case. So I don't know. You know, I'm just going to ballpark. They maybe have $300 in this thing. They're maybe making $100 on it. Also, I found the gap. Remember that gap that we had between the air filter and the motor? So this is interesting. I noticed that where the entire air unit hooks up, there are two sets of holes. And this is mounted a little bit further back. I think if I move the entire motor up to these holes right here, then my air intake filter actually would mate with the motor. But then at that point, the top of my heater unit would no longer perfectly align with the hole that they give. So here's my theory on this, and I have no idea, but I bet that the manufacturer changed some of the bolt offsettings, or maybe because this is the 300 gram unit, the tolerances of the more powerful blower were off just a little bit, and they just had to make it work. But it looks like at one time, the screw holes did allow for that air filter to actually do what it was designed to do. But again, for my unit, it doesn't do anything. So I'm going to now go ahead and finish wiring this thing up. I'm going to put it all back together now that we know what's on the inside of this, and we'll fire it up for the first time and just do some basic current draws to see how much power the motor draws, and then see how much power the heating element draws on this. All right, so temperature, I'm thinking that is degrees Celsius, 50 degrees Celsius. And all right, so I've got... Yeah, that's locked. So let's just let's take a look and see. So we're at 1 amp, and that full song, man, that is 1.9 amps. That's a 400 watt power draw there. Let's add the heat. So let's keep this on full blast. So close to 2 amps without any heat. Now I'm going to add the heat in. It's maxed out. Oh man, 15 amps of heat. And oh man, oh that is hot. That is extremely hot. I mean, I'm even a couple of feet above it and I can't keep my hand in that airflow. That is hot, hot air that comes out. I'm turning that off. My gosh. This thing is a beast. It absolutely draws the 3,000 watts of heating power that it claimed. That motor absolutely draws 400 watts of power. So, hey, from a current draw standpoint, this thing is legit. It has more than enough watts to roast 300 grams of coffee. So next step, let's roast some coffee with this thing. Okay, so I've got Artisan software running now. I have the bean temperature probe connected properly. And for the environment temperature probe, the ET probe that was in the throat, I'm not showing this on video, but I'm running it out of this box. Remember, it's just coiled up inside and held with zip ties. I exited that out the bottom of the roaster where the stock power cord used to come out. So that's where I'm getting the ET, the environment temperature reading. That thermocouple is in the throat of this I showed earlier, and then my bean temperature reading is that 5 millimeter probe stock that comes through this. I have 200 grams of beans in here now. Again, this has a 300 gram capacity, but most coffee samples are 200 grams, so I'm just starting with that. The first thing I found is, man, you can crank this all the way to max. And this little air diverter that's in here, it creates enough turbulence. Let me move the camera just a little bit. It creates enough turbulence in there that your beans still don't go out the top. They just kind of, it, It's a neat design. I mean, you shouldn't let your loft get that high, but even if you did, it shouldn't make a mess, and there is a screen on the top, so you wouldn't lose beans anyway, but it appears to be a pretty neat design. Sorry, I don't know my camera controls very well here. All right, and so I'm wanting to find a camera angle that gets both artisan software and that shows my beans well enough, and this might just do it there. All right, so I'll probably just go like in hyper speed, but I'm gonna let the camera run through this entire roast so that you can see how it goes. You can see what these readings go, and hopefully you'll be able to see a curve on artisan. I'll probably take it at like 10x speed, but here we go. And I'm at my drop temp. Okay, I've done about, I don't know, 6 or 7 different batches on this thing. And I at least have enough under my belt now to come to some conclusions on this, all of which are fantastic. First of all, I did try the other thermocouple that I had, the smaller one. It didn't work out very well. One of the main issues, I did what I have done on my artisan, which is I insert it and then I bend it upward to get it out of the airflow. But what that does on a roaster this small is it starts collecting the beans, so they don't flow as naturally. And the temperature probe on this one, the placement of it just seems to be ideal. Even if it is a little bit large, so it doesn't react as quickly as you would want it to, it just flat out works. It was certainly better than the smaller thermocouple. The other thing that I didn't show was the chaff collector on this. And hey, it works pretty well. The chaff just kind of collects in there. I didn't get a whole lot of chaff outside of this. I am in my garage. It is smoky. I don't know if you can see that. Yeah, if you see up in the lights, there's a lot of smoke in here. So, yeah, I think I'm going to move this down into my actual roasting room, and I think I'll just use the chimney that's on the artisan roaster that I have, which actually vents outside, so I'll probably try to set this up. I do think I've got a 220 outlet now. I might actually have to change my plug to a different 220 outlet, but I know I've got 220 down there that I can use. I've also verified that this works with a 100 gram batch size. I might even be able to go smaller than that, but while the company said 150 grams would be the smallest, what you're looking at right here, that's 100 grams, and it looks pretty darn acceptable. I'm not going to say it's good. A PID can certainly do better than this. I had a few dips. It's super sensitive. I mean, like a single degree of movement on that on the heat knob will change the heat. You can see the red ET curve that it's highly responsive, which is a good thing. It just means that there's gonna be a learning curve. If you're truly wanting to match a curve in artisan, it'll take some finesse and some learning of the machine. And keep in mind, I'm also changing batch sizes on every one of these things. So I'm completely out of the gate, and that's a pretty darn acceptable roast. I mean, certainly better than flying blind on an artisan. This is really gonna up my game on sample roasting. Man, I have nothing but good things to say about this machine. It's quiet, you can have a conversation over it, and I can't wait to then take the next step, which is adding these PID controls to it. PID is probably gonna be tough to tune on this because it's so darn responsive. I'm probably really gonna have to go with high derivative values, but that'll be the next challenge. I think I'm gonna end this one right here. Hey, it's worth it. It's worth under $600. Heck, you can buy almost 10 of these things for the price of 100 gram iKawa. So now, what it doesn't have the Kawa does have is this isn't auto. It's not fully automated the way iKawa is. And one of the selling points of iKawa is that roasters can then trade their profiles back and forth. So if I want to know what another iKawa roaster is doing, they can send me their profile. I can enter that into the machine, and then my machine will replicate that exact roast. But that's what I'm doing on Artisan right here. So once I do this artisan integration, and especially once I automate it using PID and a servo on here, we'll have the exact same thing. And so I could trade my roast profile to another roaster. They could plug that in and the roaster is gonna go. I mean, I can envision just having a plug and play kit that's ready to go that'll totally automate this thing, just add a few hundred bucks to the total cost of it. So you're still right at around $1,000, which is just a small fraction of the cost of an iKawa. And here we go. I mean, you just have to get the Artisan Roaster Scope software. I'd always recommend making a donation to Marco, the creators of Artisan. It's fantastic software. I can't say enough about it. But yeah, I think we're onto something really, really good. My initial reaction is buy it. Buy it now and get the thing in the mail, guys. It's fantastic.